Hello and welcome to Inside Edition, where we discuss national, regional, and international issues in depth. Water sciences and its applied technology play a great role in dealing with water challenges by producing valuable analytical insight that ensure water security, protect the water environment, and engage water management. Due to the early realization of such important aspects, the government of Bahrain consented to register the first scientific association in the field of water sciences and technology in the Arabian Gulf region. Thus, the Water Sciences and Technology Association, WSTA, was formally founded in September 1987. To know more about its role and achievements, we are pleased to be joined here at the studio by the Vice President of the WSTA and Professor of Water Resources Management at the Arabian Gulf University, Professor Waleed Khalil Zubari, right after this. Welcome back. Joining me here in the studio is the Vice President of the WSTA and Professor of Water Resources Management in the Arabian Gulf University, Professor Waleed Khalil Zubari. Thank you for being with us today.
Thank you for having me.
Doctor, first of when we talk about water resources, water sciences, and everything that goes in it, it's a vast field that we need you to help us to pinpoint. So first, could you give us an idea about what about water sciences in general and its importance in the present, the future, for both individuals and societies alike?
Sure. I would like to start by summarizing the main issue that we are having in the GCC and in Bahrain in particular. Our main chronic problem is that we have to provide water to fulfill our socio-economic development and needs with the minimum cost and price. And to do that under the condition of deteriorating water resources, as you know, we are living in a desert. Devoid of surface water resources. Our groundwater resources are called fossil. They are being developed in the deep strata something like 20,000 years ago. That's the Pleistocene age. And if you see the movie Ice Age, that's exactly where when it was developed. Now we have to rely on desalination, which is very costly, and it has some environmental externalities as well as financial cost. Under this condition, from one side, on the other side, we are having a very, you know, rapid population growth and urbanization, and changing in lifestyle, and changing consumption patterns. Under these two, you know, unbalanced, you know, conditions, there is no other option for us other than minimizing the cost. And you employing science and as well as technology in solving this problem. And when I talk about science, water sciences, we don't talk about the physical and engineering sciences only. We don't talk about desalination plants, but we also have to talk about the social scientists where and economic science, science, and we have also political science. We have to understand the behavior of the people in consuming water and how can we influence that behavior. So in our job as scientists or the science is to really communicate and understand the problem and communicate it to the decision makers and provide solutions and scientific solutions, sound scientific solutions to solve that problem. So science has, and without science you can't, we will not be able to lower the pressures on the water system, as well as, you know, you will not be able to solve this chronic problem.
Right.
And you cannot go in the future without employing science and technology. And that's actually what we are, you know, trying as scientists to do.
Right. When it comes to water sciences or as you said, the degradation or the fact that water is not available as it was, this is not a new problem. It's been there for a very long time. And actually in 1987, the Water Sciences and Technology Association has been a scientific platform at that point even that gathers many professionals concerned with all types of water affairs, whether it's the chemical components, the purity, its availability, where to get it from and everything on. Can you tell us about the establishment of the association and its stages of development?
Sure. As you have said, since 1987 there was the association. I am privileged to be serving in this non-government organization and serve the society from the other side, not the executive side, but from other side. Actually, the society or the association was established by a group of people, mm-hmm. What we call them the founding fathers or the wise people.
Yes.
In 1987, when at that time they really felt that water is really an issue and a problem, and believe it or not, those people were actually under secretaries of the GCC states.
Okay.
They are not coming from the academia or anything, but they really realized that there is a need to have academic people, executives, private sector, mm-hmm. and all those people to sit together under one umbrella. It's called the Water Science and Technology Association, and
right.
they believed in science as well as technology to solve the issues of water in the region. Mm-hmm. And the six GCC and this, these people at that time, something like they were about 20 people only.
Wow.
And now we are enjoying something like more 500
that's
people.
Amazing.
So that's a very
big leap.
Big leap for a voluntary work, an NGO. Those people have, when they had the vision that if you can bring the academics and the scientists, and if you can bring the private sector and bring the policymakers or then the executives under one umbrella through the first conference, which was done in 1992. We will be able to really reach a solution for our problem, or let's say reach a consensus on the solution, or at least identify the areas of solution that we can really, move in. And that was really a very nice and success story for
yeah.
for an NGO.
Definitely.
We are being hosted by the government of Bahrain. Thanks to the government for facilitating our operation, because we are not a Bahraini civil society. We actually a GCC, and we have to have our election, people have to come
all
over the GCC through conferences and so on. But we have been really, helped a lot by the government in doing our activities. And most of our activities has been sponsored by the government. And
yes.
When you look at the structure of the board members, we have two permanent places, mm-hmm. One for the host country, which is Bahrain,
yeah.
which is I am representing now
yes.
also, and we have the other position is the secretary general position, which is the GCC presence
yeah.
always there. So we have two people who are permanently appointed, and
right.
the others are being elected. So there is a good communication between the host country and also with the bigger
GCC.
Umbrella of the GCC.
Yeah. When it comes to the water resource issues in 1987 and the ones that we see now in 2021, is there a big difference? Has it changed? Has the cause changed? Has the
yeah.
effect changed?
Yeah, I think this is a very good question, because this is also shows you how the association has
right.
reacted to this to the problems. If you go back, in the 1980s, you will find that the main issue is how to provide water.
Mm.
There was a major emphasis on supply side.
Okay.
We need to build mm. more desalination plant to provide this booming urban population. But now we have reached a level that we have to look at the other side.
Mm-hmm.
We have to look at the demand side. We have to understand why the behavior of the consumers like that, and how can we minimize the cost by reducing the losses and enhancing the efficiency of the water use. So there has been a major change. The other thing is that at that time, you will realize that the issues we were discussing were mainly technical.
Okay.
Now it is not. Now it is political, it is social, it is economic.
Okay.
So we are trying to, encompass and incorporate other sciences inside, and also as well as artificial intelligence, and as well as robotics, as hydroinformatics. All these things are becoming part of our system. So the issues, yes, chronic,
mm-hmm.
but the shift of the emphasis or the focus has been shifting from purely physical engineering issues to really societal issues.
Right.
And that's, I think, is a very major development in addressing the water problem.
Especially when you look at the point of view of standardization of what the water quality should be like from place to place. Water quality used for agriculture
and
is different than for consumption,
yeah.
for drinking, different for medical purposes and
sure.
so on.
Yeah. Maybe I forgot to mention something that's very important. In the 1980s, there was no treated wastewater reuse. So during that time, the wastewater was not there. It wasn't in the portfolio of water supply. As we have developed more scarcity, more demands, GCC countries started to not only collect water and treat it, but also try to reuse it.
Okay.
And that to lower the, and here they came the issues of health, and here came the issue of environment.
Yeah.
And that's also another, you know, let's say sciences, or branch of sciences that we have also to address.
Right.
And that's why we have to have the people from the health
right.
side and from the environment side. So we started to become what we call it integrated water resource management instead of only sectoral water resource management. And that's very important development that have the society has undergone.
And definitely there are a lot of things that will also change in this perspective in the future. Well, the WSTA performs its duties to achieve a number of specific objectives. Can you tell us more about these objectives?
You know, our objectives, you know, consist of three major things. The first one is research, encouraging research and networking researchers.
Yeah.
The second thing is to build the capacity of water professionals. And number three is to do awareness, you know, to the society at large. So these are three functions have been, you know, since the inception of the society has been there. What changes is with time we are emphasizing something or the other.
Right.
We have been doing a lot of conferences and seminars to decision makers and professionals more than anything else. And we are doing capacity building, a lot of capacity building actually in the past 4 years for our young professionals. That they just came from the university. They are probably 1 or 2 years or 3 years in the profession, and we would like to build their capacity in certain issues.
Right.
And we have also the awareness at large, and this is part of the, you know, this is part of the awareness that we try
right.
to be in the media, and we try to show the society how its action can really help decision makers or executives in solving the water problem. So these are the three functions that we are doing. We're also doing prizes for you know, for many prizes for the best researchers, young researcher. We are doing also prizes for best short film in the media. So we are doing a lot of incentives, but putting a lot of incentives for the young people to really participate in our work, as well as directing our work really to you know, conferences where you have and seminars where you have really scientific papers put very and reviewed and, you know, evaluated before it is presented to the public.
When you have these researches that come on, the researches sometimes are from different backgrounds.
Sure.
As you've mentioned, health background, food background.
All water-related sectors, yes.
All water-related
sectors. Yeah, and our next conference, we have sessions on groundwater, we have session on desalination, we have sessions on industrial water use and in agricultural water use and domestic water use. We have also the health side.
Right.
So all these, you know, we have sessions, we are trying to cater for all sciences related to the water. But now and then we pick certain issues.
Yeah.
We have a scientific committee, I'm chairing it. We sit together and decide on what is really an emerging issue, or what is an issue that really we have, you know, a crucial issue that we have to address.
Yeah.
Our last, for instance, we noticed that in the GCC there is a phenomenon, bottled water consumption has been on the rise.
Okay.
And there is a lot of you know, marketing, what we call it, marketing. I don't want to say marketing, you know, cunning messages, yeah. but some of those people are putting mineral water, some people are putting natural mineral water, some
alkaline water.
Yes. So it is a business opportunity. Mm. So we always say, water is life,
of course.
But bottled water is a business.
Yes, true.
Okay. So we thought that from our side that we really have to address this issue, understand why the people are really drinking bottled water, mm-hmm. which is something like 1,000 times the price of the supplied water at houses, and where the government is really working so hard to provide one of the best supplied water in the world, and people don't even drink it, but it is highly subsidized. People don't drink it, and they go to the bottled water.
Yes.
So we did some research at the university and many other places on the public. Why you are using this water and not that water? And some, there is a lot of
different reasoning.
Some of them are logical. Some of them are not. Mm-hmm. Some of them are saying because of convenience. Yes, of course, I want to go and jog and I need it.
Yeah.
But to say I don't trust the domestic water supply, mm-hmm. there is some misinformation here,
mm-hmm.
or they say this is alkaline, this is not alkaline, and that's all. Yeah. So we did a seminar in Kuwait. On bottled water, we got the funding from the Arab Fund, mm-hmm. for economic and social development,
right.
And in cooperation with Kuwait Institute for Scientific Research and KFAS, which is Kuwait Foundation of the Advanced Sciences, we made a seminar. We brought the private sector, and we brought the academics. We put the regulators in the government. How do you regulate that? And we shed light on this issue,
mm-hmm.
and we came up with a very compromised recommendation that it's okay to have bottled water.
Yeah.
It's a good business, and you want people to have business, but it should not be on the expense of the consumer or the environment.
Right.
And that was, I think this is our job, is to really to explain to the decision makers all the dimensions of the phenomena. It's not only just these people are taking the water from the ground and they are desalinating and they are giving it. In some countries in the GCC, the people are taking the water supplied by the government.
Mm-hmm. Bottling it.
And bottling it and selling it.
Selling it.
Okay, and that's a good business, but this is not fair, and they should be stopped.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's what we're trying to do, is like to take one issue. We think that it is very important to shed light on it and explore it, investigate from all sides,
yeah.
and bring all parties. We don't want to be biased in one direction.
Absolutely. I mean, on the facts that you're talking about, very recently, or actually over the past 3-4 years, there were a lot of research that went into bottled water and the contaminations from the plastic bottling onto the water.
Yeah.
I remember at one point in a neighboring country of Saudi Arabia, they even had a rating system for what bottled water, plastic, didn't enter the water in heated or cold conditions and so on.
So
and that's
so
part of
yeah,
it.
Yeah, and one of the findings that we have put in that on the table is that during that seminar is that if you take the labeling of those bottled waters,
mm-hmm.
and the claim of what do they have,
mm.
and you measure it in the field, in the lab, I mean,
yeah.
it's not the same.
Yeah.
There's a lot major differences. So who's regulating? There is something called who's regulating, how they are standardizing this, and all these things needed to be, looked at seriously.
When we go to the next point, the WSTA is actually very active in terms of organizing conferences, as you have mentioned, the conference in Kuwait, and there are conferences coming up and seminars in cooperation with various regional
sure.
and international institutions. What is the importance of this kind of approach, and what are the suggested ways in order to implement these recommendations,
okay.
especially in those events?
Well, so far we have conducted 13, 13 conferences,
mm-hmm.
and our next conference is going to be in Riyadh.
Inshallah,
and all these conferences are hosted by the country. So we do a biannual annual conference. And also in the middle some seminars, but our major activity is the biannual conference, and we choose a theme.
Okay.
That theme, either it is a very important for the region, and we have to focus on it,
mm-hmm.
or we want to make a decision maker aware about that topic.
Okay.
So we choose a theme like economic efficiency. Mm. And we'd like to tell the people, all the people in the society, either executives or legislators or scientists, that the economics of water are important, and we are trying to push to increase our knowledge in that, and we come up with some understanding of that,
right,
of the economics dimension of water resources management. So each conference has been hosted, we do it alternatively in each country. Our last one was in Kuwait. Now we're going to go to Riyadh, then we'll come to Bahrain, and then we just move around to give the opportunity to all the GCCs, since we are a GCC society.
Institution, yeah.
Now, each conference has been hosted by a government institute. This time we will be hosted, it will be hosted by the Ministry of Environment, Water, Environment and Agriculture from Saudi Arabia, and it will be under the patronage of the minister. So we do have this very important connection. Again, why we are doing this? We are doing this so we have academics, private sector, executives, all those people, students, all under one umbrella to discuss a major issue of or the water issues. We do have success stories in these seminars and conferences because we have the GCC representative with us. Mm-hmm. All our recommendations at the end, the conference conclusion recommendation is being given to him.
Okay.
And he's taking it to the Secretary General of the GCC.
Okay.
And he is presenting these recommendations at the meeting of the ministers of water in the GCC. All our recommendations, the venue for our recommendation is very clear. And a lot of our recommendation, being accepted and being implemented. And some of them are, not
further
practical
studied
not practical or something. But we do convey our messages through the GCC Secretary General to the minister. We do have a success story in here. We had in our conference in March 2010 in Muscat.
Yeah.
And we called for a comprehensive, integrated, unified GCC water strategy. As an umbrella, and then we have to have all the other national strategies.
Right.
We were very, happy to have in December 2010 in Abu Dhabi, that Abu Dhabi Declaration have taken our recommendations
and applied them.
And he put it as an Abu Dhabi Declaration by their Majesties and Highnesses, the leaders of the GCC.
Yeah.
That became as like a directive for the Secretariat General, and the Secretary General started to build the GCC Unified Water Strategy based on the recommendation and see the movement from a conference to a declaration to implementation. And in 2016, December 2016, in Manama Summit, that strategy was approved for GCC.
For the whole GCC.
Amazing. It's called the GCC Unified Water Strategy.
That
so we are very happy that we have contributed in that direction. Of course, in other things that we do, a lot of our themes really hit on a certain topics that the governments really sometimes really adopt. And we talk when we trying to push the governments from the conventionally practiced supply side and supply engineering solutions to a demand side and solutions, and we can see that they want this, and many people want this, and we are trying to push in that direction
and achieve the common goal at
the common
end.
Goal for everybody.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Well, you've mentioned a little bit about the support that is provided by the Bahraini government as well as the GCC government's towers water sciences, but can you give us specifically how do you value this kind of support and where does it lie in?
Well, to start with, the minister doors is always open for us. The minister, His Excellency Wael Mubarak, is always listening to us. And he actually, when we got elected, we went and visited him to tell him that we are here and we are extend our hand for anything you want to help.
Mm.
We do have a very good relationship with the GCC Secretariat, and as well as because our job is really to help. It's not to conflict. It's not to criticize, but actually to go and contribute to the solution of a common problem that we are all facing. So we do have a lot of support. We have also financial support, actually, from the GCC countries. And they are very generous at certain times to really support our work. We have also the Arab Fund for Socioeconomic Development. We have support. We have Islamic Development Bank support. We have also the United Nations organizations support in working in the region, like ISQA and UNEP and FAO and UNDP. So we do enjoy support. Because we are a regional, and if you want to really reach to help the GCC, you will come to a regional institute instead of going to a national. This is one of the privileges that we are having.
Especially with the same kind of geography, the terrain, the resources.
Same problems, same issues. Maybe it is more pronounced in this area than that area, but it is the same thing.
Exactly.
But all starts in Bahrain.
Being the chairman of the Technical Advisory Committee for the Water Resources Council here in the Kingdom, can you tell us more about its general roles and its duties?
The Water Resources Council is headed by His Excellency Khalid bin Abdullah, the Deputy Prime Minister, and the membership of the water related ministers. The council was established in 2016. Was activated in 2016 with the purpose of a very important purpose that. We needed an umbrella for all the activities in water, to be harmonized and coordinated. And if you have a fragmented institutes, you can't work. So it was very important to build this apex body. And that apex body main job is to really formulate a comprehensive and integrated water resources strategy for Bahrain as a national level. After that, to coordinate that, the implementation of it, so there is no conflict. You know, the agricultural sector could conflict with the groundwater sector because we want to increase our water agricultural production, but it's going to might be on the expense of the groundwater. The wastewater is the result of the water supply that goes to your home and then come as a sewage. So all these subsystems that we are having need to have an apex body to have them all under one system. And that was the purpose or the function or the objective of establishing the Water Resource Council. Now, the Water Resource Council first job was to establish or formulate a national water strategy that is including all sectors and all resources, and we did that. And in February, in 1st of February, last February, the cabinet approved that strategy and its implementation plan, and also allocated the funds for it. So we are going in the right direction, alhamdulillah, and everything is going right. And now we are moving together, not everybody astray on its own sector.
Exactly, as it should be, because all of them do interact and interloop at some point.
Sure.
Well. From your point of view, what is the importance and benefits of innovation, specifically in the field of water resources?
Okay, this is a very good question, very important question. And if you look at the water sector, you will find that we have been addressing the water sector from one dimension, or one direction. And we would like to be innovative and change that direction into more aggressive dimension that can really make a difference for the water sector. So. Our problem is now what we are facing and why where we need innovation is that most of the GCC countries have adopted a management system that relies on the supply side. So there is a need, let's build desalination plant. There's a need, let's reuse our wastewater. There's a need, let's pump more groundwater. There is a need, let's harvest water. Let's make a dam and collect water. So that side of the management is not sustainable because you can't have supply sustainability. There is always an increase in the population. There's always a change in lifestyles, and there is also the population because it started to have 24 hours, 7 days a week, 365 a year, water supplied at a very low cost, they got that impression that we are living in an abundance of water not in a scarcity.
Yeah.
And that changed their perception of water. That's different from our grandfathers.
Yeah.
Our grandfathers used to go and use limited water because the water is limited. Now we feel like the water is abundant, and we are doing that. So that will not, cannot continue like that. You can't continue emphasizing the supply side and sustainability of supply. What we are trying to push is what we call it sustainability of demand.
Yeah.
We try to push the people to the other side, that losses, wastes, unused water for essential purposes should not be there. Okay, whether in the domestic, at the home, or in the field, in the agricultural field, or in the industry, all these water have a value. We are living in the desert, and we have to use them to the last drop, efficiently. So what we're trying to push is to be innovative in how to move from the sustainability of supply to the sustainability of demand, where the society understand that water is limited, it has a value, and every drop counts.
Yeah.
And you know, this is of course cannot go from physical science. You have to go to the social science. You have to the economic science. You have to go to the also, it's a humanities issue.
Right. Right.
So it is very important that people, you know, be moved from that part to that part. And
absolutely.
And traditionally, we are going in this direction. We have to go to the other direction.
Yes. Actually, when you're talking about these things, there are a lot of companies in different fields that have actually limited or changed the way they do business in order to limit the consumption of water. Like, for instance, in the medical field, I talk for the medical field because I am a nurse and I've seen this.
Okay.
There is the change from, for instance, instrument washers that are washed with water to plasma washers or
plasma
air washers, where they use heat and all these different things. Plasma washers are for the low temperature equipment and so on. And these do make an effect, and that's
and
a good step in the right
these
direction.
These are part of the innovation that we are calling for, that look at substitutes. You don't have to use them, yes.
Absolutely. Yes. And on the other hand, also, we see the immense amount of awareness Bahrain has done for the individuals, people, normal citizens and residents of Bahrain in water consumption. Also, businesses have provided water limitation or
the aerators or the lowering the flow.
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah. This is very important. But again, you need to have this mindset, you know, and the consumer itself really, you know, understand, and he should a consumer should understand the consequences of his actions, and that takes us to another issue, which is in the theory of awareness and education, we have what we call it a model called CAP, the knowledge, the attitude, and the practice.
Okay.
Okay, that CAP model is actually, if it's based on the, you know, fact that, or let's say the theory, that if you provide a person with the knowledge, okay, so that's our part, to provide him with the knowledge, and with the right attitude, he will be practicing correctly. So if I provide this, anybody who's using the water, opening the tap, in the morning, if I provide him with the knowledge that if you use the water at a certain time, that's or you are using the water or you're leaving the tap open when you are not using it, there is a consequences of this because that water has been provided to you by burning this much oil and emitting this much greenhouse gases and this much in the marine environment of reject desalination, and it has cost that much money to be provided to you, and you are just opening the tap, and that water that you are really not using it will go as a sewage, and that wastewater will be going to the treated treatment plant. It will, and because of the capacity of the treatment plant is not enough, it will be overflowed and it will be discharged untreated to the sea, and it will impact the
marine life,
and you might have a fish kill, or you might have your fish being contaminated, and then you will drink it. That type of knowledge will make, with the right attitude, of course, if his attitude is obnoxious, not going to change anything. But if his attitude and his peer pressure and all these things are conducive to that, he will be not using that. So he will be practicing. So the CAP knowledge,
yeah,
attitude, and then practice. So the practice will be done, yeah, and there will be a positive practice there. So if you can do that, okay, if you can reach to that level, then you will have a very good sustainable society.
Yeah. And that is exactly where awareness comes in. We've talked about spreading awareness regarding water challenges among societies and especially young people, but also businesses on the other hand, because water is such an essential ingredient in most of our life's products,
okay,
whether it is medication, makeup, foods, even steel utensils that you eat with,
everything,
or that you use, everything
it
water
has, it is everywhere. Well, I'll tell you, this is what we teach our students, so I'm going to just say it, you know, it's in simple words. To change behavior from, to really do a shift in consumption or to influence the consumers, you have three tools or three policy instruments. The first one is structural and operational. That what, for instance, you issue laws that the shower has to be this size and the pipes has to be this size, and
yeah,
you know, this is force. You force.
Right.
You force. You don't wait for
when
awareness.
When you standardize it,
you
it's
standardize
forced
it to a conservative, to a conservation,
yeah,
objective.
Exactly.
Metering, of course, all these things have. You know, these are called operational and structural things. So the siphon size should not be, we will not allow.
A 13 inch, 7 inch, the difference.
You will not allow it to
yeah,
come
yeah.
To it. The other policy instrument is socio-political.
Mm-hmm.
That is, you make awareness, you make education, you label appliances, so they
warning
choose.
Sign.
They choose, mm-hmm, warning sign. The most effective one and the least that we are applying, yep, and is the economic policies,
okay,
instrument, which is means you have to increase the tariff. And people look at it as increasing tariff, but I look at it as incentive, as disincentive. Yani you don't have to, you don't have to increase the tariff. You can actually exempt people from paying if they save.
Yeah,
that's
exactly.
That could be taken.
That
both
could
side.
Be taken.
Yeah,
that
both sides.
That's like a lot of places in Bahrain actually apply this now, where, like, for instance, water bottles and everything, you put them back.
You get an incentive.
You get an incentive. Another yeah, box of water.
Yeah, yeah. which is I mean, the yeah, people when I say economic instruments, people immediately think, oh, they're going to increase the tariff. No. I'm talking about both.
Mm.
But experiences and have shown that you have to apply at least two or the three of those,
mm-hmm,
if you really want it to have effective. So you go with awareness without an economic incentive, it's not going to work.
Oh, yeah.
But they will reinforce each other if you put them together. So to move from this part to that part, you have to do that. Now, when you go to the businesses, awareness is not going to work.
Okay.
Private sector, you can't go and preach them about something. I think economics will work for them.
Yeah.
If you go to the domestic side, it's a different story. You can go with awareness and a little bit of structural, where you force,
Yeah.
So each sector has its own policy instruments that you have to implement on to be more effective. So businesses, in my opinion, is, I think, regulations and tariff.
Yeah.
That will make them be more efficient in water use. They will think about recycling their water. They will be thinking a lot.
Absolutely.
And they have the means. I'm saying that because they do have the means of doing that. They can pay, they can change the system. But when you go to homes, it's really a very complex system. It's a human, behavior towards water.
But actually, that's why it's important to spread this awareness to the individuals, because even when it comes to private businesses, the individuals buy from them, and if their mindset is changed, then definitely.
So here you have to influence the.
It's a cascade.
You have what they call mobilize the consumer.
Exactly.
As a policy tool for you also.
And when we move on, the membership in the Water Sciences and Technology Association provides a connection to the regional and international water community. What are the required procedures and the conditions for those who want to become members in the society?
Society, is open for anybody who working in the GCC, whether it is a company, it's an individual, it is a ministry, anybody. It is actually, I cannot call it even association, it is actually a societal organization that everybody has the right to come in and become a member.
Right.
companies, governments, individuals, students. And we actually charge a very nominal price. I mean, it's $10 every 2 years, something like that. It's nothing.
No, it's a very good also place to start for anybody who has an interest in furthering water research and so on.
We offer our membership, but we have only one condition. Yeah. In addition to the being in the GCC, he likes to volunteer.
Before we end today's show, I'd really like to ask you, what are the future plans and the upcoming events that are prepared by the association?
Okay. The association has a strategy, a long-term strategy, but we are updating it every 4 years. Again, the major issues that the objective of the of they go around the objectives of our society, which is enhancing research, applied research, of course, for solution, capacity buildings, and awareness. Mm-hmm. These are the three things that we really, I think. What is changing in this next plan is that we are emphasizing more on the young people.
Okay.
This time, I think with the youth bulge and the percentage of the young people in our society, I think we have to look at this strata very, very seriously.
Right.
We do have a lot of young people who are really interested. They are even different from the previous generations. They are very active. Yeah. They have very good communication skills. They are aware of what's going on in the world. You can actually mobilize them very easily by putting a just cause for them in terms of water. And I think they want to contribute. They have a huge energy that need to be, I don't want to say exploited, but to be funneled toward a good cause.
Yeah.
And I think the water and the climate and the environment are already embedded in these people. And I think we can capitalize on that and try to have our society with the younger blood.
Absolutely. Like you said, climate change has always been a thing, but the new generation really focuses on it because they think about the future of their generations everything on.
Yeah, yeah.
Maybe the past generations were more about living, surviving, but the next generation is about sustainability. Exactly.
That's true.
So thank you very much, Professor, for being with us today and answering our questions. We loved having you here, and hopefully we can update this after the Riyadh.
Inshallah. I hope that I will come back after February and tell you the main conclusion results
and the new
recommendation and the new policies that came from that conference.
Inshallah.
And thank you for having me.
Thank you, Doctor. And we'd like to thank you, dear viewers, for watching us. We will see you next week in another episode of Inside Edition.